Good morning and welcome to Lighthouse Baptist Church. How many are thankful that He is risen? Say amen.
Amen.
Amen. We're going to open up with a word of prayer on this Easter morning. Father, we do love You. We thank You, Lord God, for this opportunity as we come and we worship You today. Celebrate, Lord God, the risen Savior. And Father, we are so grateful, so thankful for what You did for us. Thank You for dying on Calvary's cross. And Father, we thank You now, Lord God, You are alive. And today we celebrate that. Today we want to worship You. Today we want to make much of that. And Father, our desire, Lord God, at the Lighthouse Baptist Church is to lift You high. And Father, if there's one person here that's never trusted You, may they come to know You. We sure do love You. We thank You for it in Christ's name. Amen. Well, we do welcome you here to Lighthouse Baptist Church, and we're so grateful that you made it here this morning. We'd like to take a moment. Maybe you're visiting with us this morning. We'd like to put something in your hand. If you wouldn't mind raising your hand so that we could get this to you. Anybody across the auditorium down here, it's good to have Jeffrey, you and your family here, and right down here. And Jeffrey, we've been praying for you. Amen. And it's good to have Jeffrey and his family here. Jeffrey had gone through brain surgery there, and we've been praying for him. And several over here as well. Thank you so much for being a part of the service also. Good to see some second and third timers and see some old friends as well. Good to have my family here with me. And so thankful that they drove down from Auburn, Georgia, and to be here to celebrate a risen Savior. Amen. We're excited about today, and I pray that you will just ask God to speak to your heart through the music. The adult choir will be singing, the teenagers, the children as well. So we just want to raise His name, lift His name high, lift it up high, and worship Him this morning. But you stand as we get ready to sing. I believe it's page 36. Brother Ryan's going to come and sing this.
Absolutely. Stand with us. Grab your hymn book if you need it right there in front of you, page 36. The words will be on the screen as well. Christ arose. Let's sing A Great Truth as we start services here this morning on page 36 in your hymn book. Sing that with me. Sing that last verse with me. Death cannot keep His prey. Jesus, my Savior, He tore the bars away. Jesus, my Lord. Sing out now. Up from the grave He singing this morning. Please be seated. so much, choir. Stand with us. And these words are going to be on the screen for this one. It's going to be a combination of a couple songs. We're going to sing through these this morning to allow our choirs to transition one more time. So He is Lord. The words are on the screen. He is Lord. Sing with us on that first verse here this morning in this chorus. Sing with us. Those words are right there on the screen. Here we go. He is Lord. Time, sing it with us. He is Lord, He is Lord, and He is risen from the dead, and He is Lord, and every knee shall bow, every tongue verse. Now the iron bars are broken. Christ from death to life is born. Glorious life and life immortal on this resurrection morn. Christ has triumphed and we conquer by His mighty enterprise. We so much for singing with us this morning. You may be seated. Great job, choir. Thank you so much. Stand with us. Grab your hymn book. Page 31, He Lives. We serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. Let's sing through that song. We'll have a time of fellowship with each other after we sing through that first verse. But sing that first verse, page 31, this morning as we worship Jesus this morning. Sing with us on that first verse.
I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy. I hear His
fellowship with each other.
Second verse on page 31. In all the world around me, I see His loving care. And though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that He is leading through all the stormy blasts. The day of His appearing will come at last. And He lives, He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. With me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart.
Great singing on that last verse.
Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. And He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. To impart.
We're going to go to Lord in prayer and pray for our offering. This would be a time, if you're visiting with us today, to put your visitor's card in there. We'd like to be praying for you, and thank you once again for worshiping with us today. May I say once again, may we prepare our hearts. We've already been prepared through the music, and but may we get ready for the preaching of God's Word this morning. Let's go to Lord in prayer.
Dear Lord, we thank you for a great day. Lord, we thank you.
Sun was dead, the Savior of the world was fallen, his body on the cross and his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him. Stars as heaven looked away, the Son of God was laid in darkness, a battle in the grave and a war on death was waged, the weight of every curse forever broken. And the ground began to shake, the stone was rolled away, God's perfect love could not be overcome. So now, death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated, and forever he is glorified, forever he is lifted high, forever he is risen. He is alive, he is alive. And the ground began to shake, the stone was rolled away, God's perfect love could not be overcome. So now, death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated, and forever he is glorified, forever. sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, 'cause the Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, 'cause the Lamb is overcome. And we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, the Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, the Lamb is overcome, and forever He is glorified.
That's good, isn't it? Because He is alive, we all have a new beginning, church. Because of what He did for us on Calvary's cross, was buried in the tomb, and 3 days later, the grave could not hold Him. The sting of death, listen, it was not there. Because of what Jesus did for us, and 3 days later, He rose again. He is alive. We have much to rejoice of, much to worship Him of this morning. And because of it, there is a new beginning. My heart's been stirred. Thank you, musicians. Thank you, singers. Thank you, Brother Ryan. Thank you for the music that has pointed our attention not to ourselves, not to this church, but all to Him. Amen. And that's what we desire at the Lighthouse Baptist Church. We do want to welcome you once again and thank you for worshiping with us on this special day. It is Easter. It is what we have been praying for. It's a new beginning in several ways, a new beginning for our church. This is our second service, Sunday morning service, here on our new property. We're so thankful for what the Lord has given us. But also, it's a new beginning for those that maybe have never trusted Christ as your personal Savior. You're going to have an opportunity today. You're going to have an opportunity to receive Christ as your personal Savior. And can I say, it will be the beginning of the best days of your life. Amen. This morning, if you would, I want to take a little different approach. And I'm asking the Lord to help me just through the music. Just kind of help me with my faults and maybe where we need to go here this morning. But I take a little different approach for this Easter service than maybe you would typically go. But hang on, we're going somewhere this morning. If you would, take your Bibles, turn over to the book of Joshua, Joshua chapter 4. Joshua chapter 4. I'm privileged and honored to be a part of this wonderful church. So thankful and grateful for all that God has done and is going to do for the Lighthouse Baptist Church. The book of Joshua chapter 4. We're going to begin in verse 19. We can remain seated this morning for the reading of God's Word, but look what verse 19 says. The people came up out of Jordan on the 10th day of the first month, and they encamped in Gilgal on the east border of Jericho. And those 12 stones which they took of Jordan did Joshua pitch in Gilgal. And he spake unto the children of Israel, saying, when your children shall ask their fathers in time to come, saying, what mean these stones?
Then shall let your children know, saying, Israel came over this Jordan on dry lands. For the Lord your God dried up the waters of Jordan from before you until you were passed over, as the Lord your God did to the Red Sea, which he dried up from before us until we were gone over, that all the people of the earth might know the hand of the Lord, that it is mighty, that ye might fear the Lord your God forever. This morning, I would ask you to take your attention and look back at verse 21 out of this passage of Scripture. The Bible once again says, And he spake unto the children of Israel, saying, When your children shall ask their fathers in time to come, now get this, church, here's the question, What mean these stones? Verse 22, Then ye shall let your children know. What mean these stones, Daddy? Daddy, what means these stones that lay here? Ye shall let your children know. And here it is. Israel came over this Jordan on dry lands. When the sun arose on September 3rd of 1945, a new day, yes, had begun. But however, it began a new beginning for so many across this globe. Across this globe. You see, just hours before, aboard the USS Missouri on Tokyo Bay, Japan formally surrenders to the Allied forces, bringing an end to what we know as World War II. Celebration began across this great land. A great victory had been won. The war is finally over. And this morning, as we come to celebrate on the 16th day of April, we have much to be grateful for. You see, there was another victory that has been won. And because of that victory, each one of us can experience a new beginning as well. This morning, simply, just for the next few moments, I want to preach on this thought here this morning, church. A new beginning. A new beginning. May we go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we need you. Father, we thank you already for what we've heard and how, Lord God, Lord, we have been brought to the focus of you. And Lord, that you are alive and you are risen from the grave, Father, and because of it, we do have a new beginning. We do have life. There is victory. And Father, we thank you as we celebrate on this Easter day, Lord God, what you did for us. And Father, our goal, our desire, our prayer, Father, is that each and every person in here has experienced a new beginning. That each and every person, Lord God, this morning has experienced what you did for us on Calvary's cross, and we've accepted and we've trusted you, and I pray you would work and speak. We love you. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen. This morning, as we look at Joshua chapter 4, I want us to see, first of all, very quickly, I want us to see a new beginning for the children of Israel. We see, as we come to Joshua chapter 4, we see a new beginning for the children of Israel. As we've been studying, and those that's been here Sunday mornings, we've been studying through the book of Joshua. We've been going through the book of Joshua, and now we come to a passage of Scripture that we must take note of, a new beginning for the children of Israel. You see, for 40 years, the children of Israel, don't forget, church, have been wandering in the wilderness. You remember how God used Moses to bring the children of Israel out of exile, out of Egypt, and he had one goal in mind for the children of Israel, and that was to get them into the Canaan land. That was to get them into the promised land. He had the Canaan land and the promised land awaiting them. However, this new beginning quickly turned into 40 years of wilderness wanderings. And this new beginning of enjoying the blessings of the promised land never happened because of why, church? Because of the unbelief, because of the disobedience of the children of Israel. And now, after 40 years, we come to our passage of Scripture. Now, after 40 years, we find ourselves here in Joshua chapter 4. And God shares with Joshua, the leader of the children of Israel, on this new day, as this new day had begun, he wanted them to start a new beginning. He had something great for them. He had something in store for the children of Israel. He had a new beginning, if I may, for the children of Israel. Back there in Joshua chapter 4, verse 21, the Bible, the question was asked, or here's what God says, I want you to build a memorial of 12 stones here at the Jordan River. And as you build that, your children are going to come by in the days ahead, and they're going to stop you, and they're going to say, Daddy, why are these stones here? Why are these 12 stones piled here? Daddy, what is the importance of these stones? And then in verse 22, God gives the answer. Then you shall let your children know. This is what you're to tell your children. You're to tell them, Israel came over this Jordan on dry land. Verse 23, For the Lord your God dried up the waters of Jordan from before you, until you were passed over as the Lord your God did to the Red Sea, which he dried up before us until we were gone over. And then in verse 24, you're to build this memorial. So when the children ask, Daddy, what do these stones mean? Oh, son, let me tell you what these stones mean. These stones means that God did something great. These stones means that God performed a miracle. He dried up the Jordan River so that we could go across. And in verse 24, that all the people of the earth might know the hand of the Lord. God's people had just crossed the Jordan, and they just entered the promised land, a land of great blessing. But may I say this, it was a new beginning for the children of Israel. God's power was demonstrated. God's protection was demonstrated. God's plan, God's promise, and God wanted the children of Israel to always know what he did for them. There was a great victory. There was life after the wilderness wanderings. There was a new beginning for any and everyone who would choose God and go over the Jordan. You see, there was a new beginning for the children of Israel, but this morning I want to take our attention to the New Testament. This morning I want us to see another new beginning. This morning I want us to look at another stone, if we can. If you would, this morning take your Bible and turn over to the book of Matthew, chapter 28. The book of Matthew, chapter 28. We see a new beginning for the children of Israel, but this morning I want us to see a new beginning for Mary and for the disciples on that Easter morning. Matthew chapter 28, verse 1. We've all read this, those that's been in church any length of time. I love this account of the resurrection story. In Matthew chapter 28, I want us to see this new beginning. The reason we celebrate today, in verse 1 of chapter 28, the Bible says, in the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. Verse 2, and behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone. The stone was rolled back from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the woman, fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. Look at verse 6, church. He is not here, for he is risen. That's a good place to say amen. Amen. He has risen, Brother Register, as he said. Amen. Come see the place where the Lord lay. Verse 7, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he's risen from the dead. And behold, he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall you see him. Lo, I have told you. And they departed quickly from the sepulcher with fear and great joy. And they did run to bring his disciples word. Verse 9, and as they went to tell his disciples, now get this, church, behold, Jesus, he met them, saying, all hail. And they came and held him by the feet, and they worshipped him. Then said Jesus unto him, be not afraid, go tell my brethren that they go into Galilee, and there they shall see me. As the two Marys came at the dawn of a new day to the grave, of course, where we know they placed the body of Jesus, she noticed something different from the day before. Mary noticed something different from the day before. You see, she had realized that there was a stone rolled in front of the tomb, but on this day, when she comes to the tomb, the stone had rolled, was not in front of the tomb anymore. You see, the stone have been rolled back. It was the beginning, or it was the beginning of a new beginning. However, as we look at the stone this morning, and we think of that stone as Mary came to the tomb that morning bearing spices for her Savior, for as she comes and she noticed the stone had been moved, I realized this morning that stone represented something. That stone revealed something. Just as the children of Israel, they looked at those stones and they said, "Daddy, what mean these stones?" I look at something about this stone that was rolled away. You see, first of all, this morning, as I look at this passage, when Mary saw that the stone was rolled away, it revealed a covered tomb. The stone revealed a covered tomb. Look there in Matthew chapter 27, verse 59. Look back one chapter, Matthew chapter 27, verse 29. I want to show you something about this stone that was rolled in front of the tomb. And when Joseph, verse 59 in chapter 27, and when Joseph had taken the body, he wrapped it in a clean linen cloth, and he laid it in his own new tomb. Joseph of Arimathea, he came and he requested the body of Jesus, and when he did, he laid it in a new tomb. Now look what happened, which had been hewn out of the rock. And he, being Joseph, he rolled a great stone to the door of the sepulcher. You see, this morning, that stone, it revealed a covered tomb. This covered tomb revealed also that there obviously death had taken place. Because the tomb door was covered, it revealed a covered tomb, which obviously told people somebody is dead, somebody has died, somebody's body has been placed into the tomb. It's just as we see headstones in the cemetery. We are reminded that someone has passed away. But may I say this, as we think of the tomb on that Easter morning when Mary came and she noticed that the tomb door was open, that the stone was rolled away, we must take note that first of all, that stone revealed a covered tomb, and it revealed that death had taken place. Now take your Bibles and look at Matthew chapter 27. And look at verse 27. You see, just hours before this, just a couple days before this, there was someone who died. There was someone whose life was taken, who willingly laid down his life. In Matthew 27, verse 27, then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the common hall, and they gathered unto him the whole band of soldiers. And they stripped him. They stripped Jesus. Now listen, we're looking at this tomb that was covered. It's obviously somebody had died. Obviously somebody's body was laid in there. And may I say, it was Jesus. Amen. He had died on that. He had laid his life down on the cross. And now we find this account. Verse 28, and they stripped him, Jesus, and they put on him a scarlet robe. Look what Jesus did. And when they had plaited a crown of thorns, they put it upon his head, and a reed in his right hand. And they bowed the knee before him, and they mocked Jesus, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." And they spit upon him, and they took the reed, and they smote Jesus on the head. And after that, they had mocked him. They took the robe off from him, and they put his own raiment on him, and led him away, get this church, to crucify him. What was the tomb? Whose body was in the tomb? Who had died that the tomb was now covered? Can I say, Jesus went to the cross and he died for you and I. Amen. Look at verse 46. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," that's so to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" Some of them that stood there, when they heard that, said, "This man calleth for Elias." And straightway one of them ran and took a sponge, and they filled it with vinegar and put it on a reed and gave Jesus to drink. Verse 49. The rest said, "Let be. Let us see whether Elias will come to save him." And look at verse 50. Jesus, when he cried again, here it is, church, with a loud voice, he yielded up the ghost. Jesus died on the cross. Brother Chad, why would he do that? Why would Jesus go to the cross and let men nail him to the cross? Why would he do that? Can I say this, ma'am or sir? He wants you to experience a new beginning. He wants you to experience a new life. He wants you to experience something, listen to me, that only comes by faith in what he did for us on Calvary's cross. Amen. You see, that stone this morning, Hey, when Mary came to the tomb, it revealed that there was a covered tomb. Somebody had died. Death had taken place. The tomb was covered. We know Joseph of Arimathea, he requested the body. They laid the body in the tomb, and he covered the tomb. The stone revealed a covered tomb, but also I realized this as Mary came to the tomb that day. You see that stone when she came, bearing those spices, and she saw that stone. Yes, it revealed that somebody had died, but number two, that stone that was moved, it revealed an open tomb. It revealed, first of all, a covered tomb, but now it revealed an open tomb. As Mary came to the tomb on that third day, she discovered something different from the day before. You see, the stone had been rolled back, which revealed an open tomb. And may I say, it was the beginning of something new. It was the start of something great. Hey, it was victory, a new beginning. That stone, it revealed an open tomb, but I see this also, that stone revealed an empty tomb. It's one thing for the tomb to be open, but it was a far another thing. Look at this, church, in verse 6 in Matthew 28. As Mary comes to the grave and she sees the stone, it was moved. Hey, it revealed that death, but also when she saw the stone was moved, it revealed an open tomb. But as she stood there in amazement of what's going on, why is the tomb moved? What's taking place? All of a sudden, an angel says, "Oh, Mary, don't be afraid. He is risen." You see, it revealed an empty tomb. Jesus was alive, and the rolled back stone revealed to Mary, and it reveals to us today that Jesus, as Brother Ryan so wonderfully sang about, He is alive. Amen. He is alive. A new beginning this morning. We see here, yes, for the children of Israel as they crossed the Jordan River, what mean these stones? But we also see a new beginning for Mary and the disciples as she comes and she sees another stone, this stone that revealed that Jesus was alive. But may I say this morning, I see a new beginning for you and I today. As the stone revealed a new beginning for the children of Israel and for Mary, we must take note that the empty grave this morning, it reveals to us a new beginning as well. It reveals a new beginning as well. I don't know this morning who entered this building needing something new. I don't know this morning who entered this building needing a special touch, maybe needing a new path, maybe needing a new direction. Maybe you're saying, "I just need a new lot in life." Hey, can I say this morning? There is a new beginning awaiting each and every one of us. Amen. I do not know who sits here and the needs that you might have, but I do know this. We all, every one of us, needs a new beginning. May I say, first of all, as I think of this new beginning, and we'll be done just momentarily, but listen to this, church. The crux of the message right here. May I say, first of all, as we think of a new beginning, when Jesus rose from the grave, I see, first of all, a new day. There in Matthew 28, verse 1, it says, "As it began to dawn." As you woke up this morning, can I say this? We're all in here awake. We're all in here breathing. We all in here are gotten ready. We've made our way down to 104 Dub Walker Road. Can I say, it's a new day for each and every one of us. Today we start afresh. Today we start new. And may I say it this way, today we can start a new beginning. Or we can have a new beginning. May I say, as the sun arose on that day, a little over 2,000 years ago, it was the beginning of the greatest day in history. If Christ had not risen, you realize, church, there would be no hope. If Christ had not risen, there would be no heaven. If Christ had not risen from the grave, I'm thankful that He died. Don't get me wrong. I'm grateful He went to the cross and died for me. And when they put Him in the tomb, I'm glad His body's still not in the tomb. He is alive, because here's the thing, church. On that new day, as we see in Matthew 28, verse 1, the beginning of a new day, the began to dawn, on that new day, Mary discovered that He was alive, and that began a new beginning in her life. It can begin a new beginning in our life as well. What we find is that if we will trust Him and see the risen Savior. Hey, we too. Hey, yes, there's a new day, a new beginning for all of us. I don't know what this day brings, but it can be a new beginning in your life. This new day, it brought in Mary's life a new joy. Look there in verse 8. And they departed quickly from the sepulcher with fear, and get this, church, and with what? Great joy. Get the picture. Mary comes to the tomb. She realizes the tomb door is open. She knew that death had taken place. She knew that Jesus' body was in there. She had just seen Jesus lay his life down on the cross. She knew it. But that empty tomb, or that tomb, it revealed, yes, a concealed tomb, which revealed death. It revealed an open tomb. It revealed an empty tomb. And because of it, a new day began. And because Jesus has risen, look what happened. She left there quickly after hearing he is risen with great joy. The joy on Mary's face, I was thinking about. Could you imagine her face? If it was in 2017, I would have loved to have seen a selfie. Wouldn't you have heard? Wouldn't you? Everybody's in that selfie, you know, mode. Take us. Could you imagine if you saw Mary's face when she took a selfie? The excitement, the joy that had taken place as she now sees the empty tomb. She was running to tell the disciples. Can you imagine this morning? There's no doubt that someone in here needs new joy. Someone in here on this new day that God has given you, you need new joy. And that joy, true joy, can only come from a risen Savior. Amen. You've been searching for happiness in everything except Christ. You've turned to everyone in everything else, except you have not turned to Jesus Christ. And that's where you find joy, ma'am. That's where you find happiness, sir. Oh, you can have a new beginning. Hey, on this new day that God has given us, you can have new joy. And look at verse 9. How did she have new joy? Because of the new assurance. And I love this right here about how to spell at my house studying. Look at verse 9. And as they went to tell his disciples, Mary's come, she sees the empty tomb. The angel said, he's not here, he's risen. She's got great joy. She hasn't seen him. And she's running to tell the disciples, he's alive. Could you imagine her expression? Could you imagine her face? And as she goes, as she went to tell the disciples, behold, Jesus met them. Jesus met them. Mary had seen the open tomb. She had seen the empty tomb. She had heard the voice of the angel saying, he is risen. But now her doubts of could it truly be were ended. Now her doubts of wondering, is he really alive? It has been placed down because now Jesus meets her. Amen. Her new day and new joy was met with a new assurance that he really is who he said he was. Amen. And he really did what he said he would really do. You see this assurance, and may I say in here this morning, it is one thing for the preacher to say, trust in Christ. But it's a whole nother thing when we look in Scripture and we see the risen Savior and we go ahead and by faith we trust him and we have that assurance within us. I mean, it changes us. Amen. It does something. It does bring a new joy, a new beginning. Oh, don't trust the preacher says. Trust what the Bible says. And my job as the preacher is to share what the Bible says. Amen. God's Word tells us he is alive. It's a new beginning. Rest assured this morning, you too can have great assurance of salvation, of a new life, of a new beginning when you put your faith in Jesus. Question must be asked. Have you met him? Have you met the risen Savior? Have you put your trust in him, church? Did you come in here empty? There's no doubt with the room this size that maybe there's somebody in here. Maybe you have never put your trust in Jesus Christ. Can I say God's given you a new day? And God wants to give you a new joy. And it only will happen with a new assurance of believing and trusting that God truly, he is alive. Amen. You can rest assured when God says it, he means it. Stop questioning it. Stop doubting it. And just go ahead and believe it. Brings a new joy. I see this lastly. Look what happens when we meet Christ. You know what will happen, ma'am, sir, when we meet Christ? Yes, we'll discover a new joy. We get that joy because of this new assurance that He truly is who He said He is. And listen what happens. We see a new experience. Look at verse 9. And as they went to tell His disciples, behold, Jesus met them. She saw it. She was assured at that moment He was truly alive. He is risen. And they came, and look what they did. As soon as they saw Christ, as soon as they met Him, they held Him by the feet and they worshiped Him. Do you see the new experience? Do you see what happened? It is amazing when God gets a hold of your life and when you realize He is who He says He is. He has done what He says He will do. It is amazing how it will change your life. You will experience a new life. I am here a testimony of what Jesus Christ can do to one. Amen. I am here this morning to tell you I was a sinner who was bound for a devil's hell. Hey, listen to me, but Jesus came into my life, and because of it, listen, today I want to worship Him. Today I want to hold His feet. Today I want to tell Him, hey, I am so grateful and thankful for what He did for me on Calvary's cross. That's what Jesus does. He gives you a new experience. He gives you a new lot in life. He changes your old ways, Brother Bridges. He changes your old ways, and He does something new in your life. That drunkard who's been struggling with alcohol, it's amazing how God can change that person. That druggie who's been on drugs all his life, it's amazing what God can do to a new person. That's why people say, how can you go to church all the time? How can you worship? Because that's just what God does when He changes your life. Is it not? A new day, ma'am, sir. You can experience on this new day a new joy by seeing a new assurance that God is who He says He is. And you can experience this new worship. Mary worshiped Jesus. This morning, do you need a new beginning? A new experience. Oh, that you would trust Him. Oh, that you would see the empty tomb. Oh, that you would see the stone that was rolled back and that Jesus has risen. It's a new day, a new joy, a new assurance, which results in a new experience. As the children of Israel crossed the Jordan into the promised land, they experienced a new beginning for their life. Mary experienced, and the disciples, a new beginning. And ma'am, sir, you too can experience a new life with Jesus Christ. So many people try to do it on their own. I've got this. I can do life. I don't know about all this church stuff. I don't know about all this. Stop questioning. Start believing. You will see what God can do in your life. On September 3rd, 1945, yes, it was a new beginning for America. You see, World War II had just come to a close. However, as we've studied this, maybe you're not familiar with the story. It's an amazing story about a Japanese soldier named Onad. Onad was fighting the battle. Onad was commissioned by his the leaders above him to go to war, him and a few men, and they were to keep fighting and fighting until somebody came and get them. And his leaders told him, you never, ever, ever surrender. You keep going. You keep fighting. You realize as we read this story of Onad, a true story, the war had ended in 1945. For 29 years later, the story is told that this Japanese soldier never surrendered. He kept on fighting. Onad never experienced the new day. He never experienced September 3rd. He never experienced the end of the war, the new beginning, as the world did on September 3rd. You see, when he heard that the war was over, he didn't believe it. He was in the jungles. Leaflets, they said, were coming down, and they were saying, the war is over, the war is over. Onad and a few of those men that was with him, they picked those leaflets up, and they thought it was propaganda from the Allied forces. Oh, they're tricking us. They're telling us the war is over and to surrender, and he didn't do it. He said, we're not surrendering. We're not giving up. For 29 years, he never believed until a man in 19, I know it's hard to comprehend, is it not? In 1974, finally, a man found Onat and persuaded him and convinced him that the war was over. For 29 long years, he wasted his life fighting a battle that had already been over. And this morning, there may be one, maybe someone in here, you just don't believe what Christ has done. You just don't believe, just as Onad was like, it is false, it is skeptical, there's no way, the war is over. And you are just like this man, you're skeptical, doubting, and in disbelief. May I say this morning? Would you just surrender? Would you just raise the white flag of surrender and just say, you know what? God's given me a new day. God wants to give me a new joy because of a new assurance that Jesus truly is alive. You've been shown in Scripture, church. And I want to experience new worship, new experience. It's going to take us to surrender. Say, God, I'm done. I'm over. We're going to walk out. Say, God, I'm yours. Take over. I believe in you. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed this morning. Auditorium is full this morning. I realize there's people on every side of us, in front of us. But can I say the greatest thing we need to be focused on this morning is ourselves, not the person beside us, in front of us, or behind us, but the person that's seated right there in that seat, and that is you. Ma'am, sir, can I ask the most important question? Do you need a new beginning? Have you been searching? Did you come in here empty? Or have you been looking for joy? Maybe you have never put your trust in Jesus Christ. And maybe you just need to surrender. Just give up. I'm done battling. I'm going to stop trying to do it myself. I'm going to stop being skeptical, and I'm just going to believe what God says. It is true. The greatest day of my life is the day I received Christ as my personal Savior. It began a new beginning for me. Since that day, I've seen family members come to know Christ. Since that day, I've seen my children come to Christ. Since that day, I've seen God do amazing things. Yes, it's been tough, and yes, we've had experienced life, but I'm so grateful for what Jesus did for me. Ma'am, sir, can I just say the greatest thing you can do is give your life to Him? And I wonder, heads are bowed, eyes are closed all over this auditorium. I wouldn't dare embarrass you, but I do want to pray for you. And I wonder in here this morning, maybe there's someone that says, Brother Chad, I'm not for sure that heaven's my home. I've never put my trust. Brother Chad, I want this new life. I want this new joy. I want to experience total joy in what Jesus did for me on Calvary's cross. Just pray for me. Anybody like that, raise your hand. That's me. I see one. Anybody? I see another. Anybody say, that's me? That's me, preacher. I'm not for sure. I'm not for sure. I don't know. Listen, this morning, if you raised your hand, in just a moment, we're going to have a song of invitation. Even if you didn't raise your hand, you've never asked Jesus to come to your life and to forgive you of your sins. As we stand in just a moment, we're going to sing. Heads are going to be bowed. Eyes are going to be closed. Nobody's going to be looking. It's a private time between you and the Lord. Would you step out? Would you allow us to take the Bible and show you how you can know for sure heaven's your home? I'm going to ask you. Listen, God's giving you a new day. Oh, that you would experience a new joy because of the assurance that God, He is alive. Oh, would you do that? Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. We're going to stand across the auditorium. As we're standing, would you pray, church? Would you pray? This morning I got a text. I got a call this morning. I said, from a person in our church, said, please pray, please pray. I'm going to witness to my daddy. Going to witness to my daddy. Got a text. His daddy, I'm not for sure how old, 70 and 80s. He received Christ as his personal Savior. Ma'am, sir, a new day began for him. A new beginning. May that happen in your life as well. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed as we sing. Would you step out? You need Christ. You want to experience what He can do for you. Oh, that you would trust Him as we sing this morning.
Oh,
to Jesus I surrender all. To Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily live. And I surrender all. I surrender all to Thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all.
Heads are bowed, eyes are closed this morning. I want to ask this church. Maybe you're saved, you've received Christ, but you're not experiencing the joy. You haven't claimed your Canaan land. You've been wrestling, you've been struggling, you've been fighting, you've been doing your own thing instead of what God says. You know for sure heaven's your home, but you've been running, you've turned your back. Can I say God's given you a new day? A new day, a new day, a new day. You are not promised tomorrow. Would we begin right now? Would we begin saying, I give up, I surrender, God, I want to do it your way. I'm tired of trying to do it my way. I want this joy again. I want to experience true worship. That's my desire. As we sing one more invitation, would you pray? The altars are open this morning as we sing.
To Jesus I surrender, Lord. I give myself to Thee. Fill me with Thy love and power, and let Thy blessings fall on me. And I surrender all to Thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all to Jesus. I surrender all. Lay at His feet I bow. Pleasures all forsake and take me, Jesus, take me now. And I surrender all, I surrender all to Thee, my blessed Savior. Surrender.
Father, we do come to You today and we thank You, Lord God, for what You've done for us, Lord, as we truly take this day. Lord, every day is Easter. Every day, Lord, we celebrate a risen Savior. But today, Lord, today, we're grateful, Lord, for what You did for us. Thank You for the new beginning You gave me in 1992. And Father, I know there's many who could rejoice in that as well. Father, if there's one person that hasn't experienced You, hasn't put their trust in You, believe what You did for on Calvary's cross for them, Father, would they come to know You? Father, we love You. We thank You for Your goodness to us. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Pastor Kenny's going to come. We're going to pray, have a prayer of dismissal. Thank you, church. I hope that you can be back here this evening, 6 o'clock. We'll be back. And for our evening service, Pastor Kenny's going to dismiss us.
For being here to celebrate a Jesus that is alive, amen. Just want to run by a couple quick announcements. When you leave here on the foyer, you go to the right, you'll notice our new table. There's a few sign-up sheets. And coming up this 22nd, Senior's Day to Callaway Gardens. So if you're in their class, if you have any questions, see Brother Mike, but please go by there and put your name down on that. Next two Saturdays from now, we've got our men's fishing tournament. So really excited about that. So if you have any questions, please see me. But that's also out there on the sign-up table. And then also lastly, before we dismiss, we are getting ready for camp. We're going to Pensacola. So if you're a teen or if you know of a teenager that would like to go, as we know, many decisions are made at camp, and we're excited about the decisions that are made at camp. And so we've got our sign-up sheet. So please go by the student ministry table, and you'll be able to pick one up. But thank you again for being here. Let's pray. Father, we do love you, God. We're thankful today that you are alive. God, we thank you that today we worship a risen Savior. Lord, I pray now as we go our separate ways, I pray that you'd give us a good afternoon. Lord, and I pray that you'd bring us back safely tonight. Be with the service tonight. Pray that you'd move again with us, Lord. And if there's somebody that's still questioning, God, still doesn't know, I pray today they'd be saved for us everlasting too late. We love you. Thank you again for all your many blessings. In your name I pray, amen. You are dismissed. Thank you.